Montgomery Independent School District Board of Trustees. I'd like to call the meeting to order. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Ms. Alcantara, are there any public comments? There are no registered public comments, so the board will go into closed session as authorized by the Texas Open Meeting Act. For the reasons listed on our agenda, we will return shortly. Ladies and gentlemen, we are returning from our closed session. Board members, are there any motions?
I'd like to move that we approve the superintendent's evaluation as presented in closed session.
Thank you, Mr. Kirby. Is there a second?
I'll second.
All right, Ms. Turner, thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
And abstained.
That motion carries. Are there any other motions?
I'd like to make a motion to approve the amendment number 3 to the superintendent's contract.
Ms. Porton, thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Hopkins, thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? And abstained? That motion carries. Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes the closed session portion of our meeting. But wait, there's more. I need the regular agenda.
Sorry. I don't think I have it.
Is that right? Is that it?
This is the December 20th, 2022 regular meeting of the Montgomery Independent School District Board of Trustees. I'd like to call this meeting to order. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for joining us tonight. Dr. Morrison, do we have any special recognitions?
We do. We have some of our amazing employees we're going to honor tonight, and then we have an exceptionally talented group of our students. And so I believe we're going to start with our employee recognition, and we're going to ask our Assistant Superintendent of Communications and Government Affairs, Justin Moreno, to start those recognitions.
Good evening. So this is officially the safest room in the state of Texas right now. January 9th is Police Officer Appreciation Day. So this is our last board meeting before that date. We wanted to take a moment to recognize these very, very special women and men who serve in our police force. One thing I wanted to point out that I always appreciate seeing is their relationships that they build with students and staff members on a personal level, almost just as important as, you know, the other work they do to keep our schools safe. But with that, I want to call up Chief Phillips to introduce his team and say a few words about them.
First of all, I want to say thank you to the board for entrusting me with this great opportunity to lead such great men and women of the police department. It has been a great opportunity for me, and we have a great bunch of officers here associated with Montgomery ISD and the police department. So at this time, I am going to introduce them. I have to look at them because some of them are new. So starting off, we want to introduce probably the longest tenured officer who works truancy, Officer L.A. Washington.
Good
Officer Romeo Larrera, who works at Lone Star Elementary. Officer Spradlin, who works at Lincoln Elementary. We have Officer Reed, who works at Montgomery Junior High. Officer Edwards, who works at Oak Hills Junior High. Officer Stewart, who works at Montgomery High School. Officer Hyder, who works at Lake Creek High School. Officer Trott, who works at Stewart Creek. I'm sorry, Mainly Ranch. Officer Kuntz, who works at Montgomery Elementary. And Officer Lewis, who works at Stewart Creek Elementary. We also have Officer Bolden, who is currently working at a basketball game tonight, and he's at Montgomery Junior. Officer Silvio, who's out sick, who works at Lake Creek, and Officer Alvarez, who works at Keenan Elementary. Also, we have Sergeant Kendall, who is the supervisor over our operations department. And the glue that holds our department together, our administrative assistant, Ms. Daffrey Richmond.
Squeeze in some more.
Yeah, if y'all can all kind of angle into the center right there and just squeeze in as close to the back as we can. And make a window so I can see everybody's face. Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3. Great. Thank y'all very much.
Chief Phillips, before you leave, I have a quick question for you. Can you go back to the podium there? We recently took surveys of our community, our staff, and our students. What was the highest rated department in Montgomery ISD?
The police department.
Now, that makes me, what was the highest rated department last year?
The police department.
And you set a really high bar last year. What was the percentage of overall students and staff might feeling safe at school?
Last year was 96%.
And what was it this year?
97%.
All right.
I just want to say a sincere thank you to the men and women in the back of the room standing. And our boys and girls in blue, and to the parents in the room, if you're ever wondering how we keep our schools safe, it starts with them, starts with everybody in our community taking a moment to think about what we can do to keep our schools safe. And to our police officers, we love you. There's nothing we can say or do that would ever show you just how much we're grateful for y'all. So thank you for all you do in keeping our schools safe every day. All right. Other special recognitions?
Well, we love being able to recognize the phenomenal students we have, and whether it's their performance on the classroom or on fields, or in this case, the stage, our kids are doing amazing things in Montgomery ISD. So, Justin, are we going to recognize some theater students tonight?
Sure. Can Ms. Morgan and Mr. Ramirez join me? So we have some outstanding students here tonight. Recently competed at the State Thespian Festival before the Thanksgiving break, and they returned with some amazing recognition for their performances, and they're extraordinarily talented. Montgomery ISD, Ms. Nicole Morgan, and her students were recognized as national qualifiers. I want to call them up individually. We have Carly Clammer for stage management. Kirsten Wilson for costume design. Jonathan Stover for costume construction. Victoria Matfeld for solo musical theater dance. Harris Clammer for solo musical theater performance. For group acting, we have Ryan Barfield, Owen Brown, John Cathy, Adela Morton, and Kirsten Strode. More group acting, Caden Chrisman, Reese Grotchett, and Braden Havard. And for lighting design, we have Rhiannon Gell. And for Lake Creek, we have Buck Bloom for short film and monologue. Madeline Heinrich for Playworks. Katie Kowalik for monologue. Dalton Chaney for monologue. For duet acting, Ian Terry and Huntley Jett. For duet acting, Madeline Heinrich and Kinsey Williams. Solo musical, Mia Pasterny. And for stage management, Sarah Ramirez Correal. So we have two performances that we'd like to show the board and our audience here tonight. So why don't we start with Montgomery High School?
Ms. Marina, do we want to do some pictures first and then sure. Do the performances? Okay.
Sure, we'll take a photo.
Okay,
So this is Karis Clammer with Montgomery High School.
And I was a
I'm glad I don't have to follow that. But Kinsey and Madeline get to follow that from Lake Creek.
Time.
Students, as the board was making its way up there, we were wondering if we needed to sing for y'all and we'll spare y'all from that. I'd like to say to our students and to your families that are here tonight, the theater department and the fine arts in general represent for all of us up here one of the greatest points of pride, one of the most emotionally poignant moments that we've had in our schools are thanks to the talent that y'all bring to the stage and behind the stage, the hours of practice that y'all do, so thank you. You bring beauty and light and love into our community, so thank you, and let's give them a round of applause one more time.
I know in the arts there's a saying that you don't do it for the money, but Karis, did you happen to come across any dollars coming your way recently?
Yes, sir.
You want to share? Inquiring minds would like to know.
I received a $52,000 scholarship
to Oklahoma City University. To our broader community, if you have not had a chance to go see some of the amazing performances at both Lake Creek and Montgomery, I would invite you to do that. You're in for a treat. I happened to take my wife, and she didn't think it was a date night, even though I thought it was, when we saw Frankenstein. My son went to a performing arts school, one of the finest in the entire country, but I saw two of the most amazing performances by the young man who played Frankenstein and the young man who played Frankenstein's monster, and to carry a whole, was it the second act, for like 40 minutes of nothing but dialogue. Dr. Fuller, you went, I mean, it was just amazing. So congratulations to all of our students, but to the parents, being a theater arts dad myself, I know how many hours you put in, and to our directors, thank you, and we are very grateful for the talent that you allow us to witness in this community. So let's give our parents and our directors a big round of applause.
Are there any additional special recognitions?
That's it. How do you top that?
I'm not even going to try. Ms. Alcantara, are there any registered public comments? All right.
For students and parents, this is where you can exit stage right if you want to. The rest of the board meeting goes downhill after you guys.
That's a good point. All right. Board members, we're moving on to consent agenda. Is there a board member that would like to pull an item off of the consent agenda? Hearing none, then I would like to see if there's a motion to approve the consent agenda.
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Mr. Hopkins has made the motion. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Mr. Robb has seconded. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed and abstained, the consent agenda carries. All right, now we're going to take a little break and let everybody exit. Got that business out of the way. All right, ladies and gentlemen, action items. Tonight, first action item, we're considering the approval of recommended name and mascot for Elementary 7. Dr. Morrison?
Yes, we will be having our Assistant Superintendent of Communications, Mr. Justin Moreno, come up. And then we have a principal who has been helping us with the preparation and planning for Elementary 7, Ms. Shelby Smith of Madeley Ranch. And they're going to do the big unveil and ask for your approval.
Good evening again, Board of Trustees. Excited to tag team this with Ms. Smith. We had the privilege of chairing the name recommendation committee for Elementary School 7, so I know it's been much anticipated, so we're excited to present that recommendation to you tonight. A little background, Elementary 7 was approved by voters as a part of the May 2022 bond referendum. It is intended to alleviate growth in the feeder patterns serving Stewart Creek and Keenan. It will be in the Lake Creek High School feeder pattern, located adjacent to Lake Creek High School, back behind the building, and it will serve approximately 900 students. The timeline for the naming committee In September, we issued a district-wide survey to collect suggestions. We received over 600 from our community. We'd like to thank everybody who submitted their recommendation for the name and the mascot. In October, we convened a naming committee that consisted of staff members and parents from the Lake Creek High School feeder pattern. Those individuals were nominated by principals in the Lake Creek High School feeder pattern, and we're recommending the name tonight.
All right. The committee considered the new school's feeder pattern and put forth a recommendation that would acknowledge the mascot and colors of Lake Creek High School. They also considered the facility naming traditions of Montgomery ISD, and they considered the need to create a unique identity for the school, which would be easily discernible from the existing MISD campuses.
So, without further ado. Recommending the Creekside Elementary School Cubs.
All right, great.
It's cute.
Board member, Mr. Marino, Ms. Smith, anything else?
That's it.
All right. Quick questions. I know the answer to this first one. Y'all didn't just pull this out of a hat, did y'all?
The name?
Yeah. Absolutely not. So as community members, I would hope that you understand and we recognize just the hard work that's gone into the committee collecting information, the administration, parents, everyone offering input. And so this feels like a community decision to me. Would that be a correct statement?
I would say absolutely.
Yes, we received over 600 suggestions, and several of those were actually Creekside Elementary School. So.
And every name, every suggestion was reviewed. It's not like certain ones were selected. Everyone on the committee was given the opportunity to review all of those and kind of narrow it down from there.
I was there.
Yes.
What she's saying is true.
Creekside Cubs. All right, board members, are there any questions? All right, who would like to make the motion naming a school? This is a very rare occasion for a board member to do, so.
I'll make a motion.
Mr. Robb, what's your motion?
Motion is to accept the Creekside Cubs as the next elementary seven.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Mr. Hopkins, thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed and abstain. That motion carries unanimously. Congratulations, everyone. And let's be sure to welcome the Creekside Cubs in the next coming year when they got a lot of work to do ahead of us. So thank y'all. All right, action item 6B, consider approval of purchases over $50,000 using bond funds. I somehow think this is going to involve Mr. Chris Lynn.
It might, just a little bit. Good evening. So yes, we recently put out early package number two for, you know, with the global supply chain issues that we're still experiencing for Creekside Elementary and Lake Creek High School Edition. That early release package two included switchgear, generator, and ATS for Creekside Elementary at a total cost of $333,794. And for the Lake Creek High School Edition includes the student parking lot expansion, which total cost is just over $1 million. For that parking lot. So we're asking for your approval of these items this evening so that Pogue Construction can finalize the contracts to the appropriate vendors. If you do move forward with this approval tonight, the student parking lot expansion at Lake Creek would start in February, so before you know it. So that's what we're asking this evening.
Questions? How much are we growing on the parking lot? How many spaces?
To be exact, 243.
200, wow, that's pretty specific.
See Mr. Williams in the back there, is that going to be enough? Well said, Mr. Williams.
That's our first expansion. Whenever we get ready to do the addition, there is some additional parking plan for that as a part of the actual addition as well. So
when will students actually get to park in those 243 spots?
So we will get the parking lot done as quickly as possible. One of the items that is a long lead item is the light poles for the parking lot. So we may have a parking lot before we have lights. So as soon as we can get that parking lot done, we will and start allowing the campus to use it. Hopefully, most of that should be complete before the end of school.
Other questions? All right, then I'll take two more if you don't mind, Mr. Lynn.
Yes, sir.
As I understand it, we established Pogue as our construction manager at risk so they can handle everything with RFPs, making this all happen. All that kind of stuff is handled for us, correct?
Yes, sir. They are the ones who actually put this bid out on our behalf, and they've been having conversations with subcontractors, and particularly there's some local subcontractors who submitted some proposals for this work. So with your approval, some of our local businesses will see some work from this project.
That's an excellent addition. Thank you for answering that. And then the last question I have is not really a question, more of a statement. If anyone's interested in the progress of the bond packages, I believe they can go online and see how this is all unfolding, kind of look in the books, if you will.
Sure. So each month we post our bond update on our website. Right now, most of, you can't go out to a site and see something coming out of the ground, so most of it is still the planning and things like this. But we do put notes in there about each particular project. But more importantly, they can see how the dollars are being spent. That's our way of saying thank you to this community for their support in May and showing them that we take this responsibility very seriously and we are spending their money in an appropriate way.
Great. Any other questions? All right. Is there a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the purchases as presented.
Thank you, Ms. Porton. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Thank you, Ms. Turner. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? That motion carries unanimously. Thank you, Mr. Lynn. Moving on to information items. Information item 7A, parent night and student survey.
Thank you, Dr. Fuller. As we're going to do a little bit of a deep dive into goal two tonight, which is the focus on safety and security of our students and staff. There's always the idea of the physical safety of our campuses and our students, and that's incredibly important. But the safety and well-being and taking care of our students goes well beyond that. For many of us that have gone through our educational programs, we heard about this guy named Maslow, and he had this thing called a hierarchy of needs, and you kind of learned it for the test, but then you actually start teaching and you realize if kids come into our classrooms and they're hungry or they are frightened or they have some mental or social emotional need that's not being met, they're really challenging to teach. And so as a school district that is trying to make sure we take care of the needs, the academic needs of every single student, we also have to make sure that we're going above and beyond to make sure that they come into our classrooms ready to learn. I could not be more proud of our family, of our Office of Family and Community Engagement, which has a full staff of one employee, Courtney Dyer, but she is ably assisted by Dr. Amy Busby, and they already have too much on their plate. But knowing the needs that our school district has and our community, they have gone well above that. And we want to present to you the next step of trying to make sure that we're being responsive to the needs of our students with what we're calling our parent nights and student surveys. So Dr. Busby, to you.
Yes, we're very excited to talk about this project that's coming up. Parent nights will be starting in the spring, and we'll talk a little bit more about the student survey, but we'll let Courtney kind of kick us off.
Yes, so as you know, on goal two, it really focuses, objective four focuses on student wellness, and it reads that MISD will implement best practices relating to mental health awareness and training, trauma-informed training, character education, and mentor programs. So really centering around that mental wellness, mental health piece for our students. So you may be thinking, so why is MISD doing another survey? Didn't we just survey, our secondary students, in the fall, and why parent nights? So even though we got great information from that survey, it left us with the question of, what more, wanting more. I have the privilege of working with all the counselors across the district, and so as we have conversations and as we're, you know, planning and trying to figure out how we can make progress toward these goals, how we can best support students, they wanted to find out more. So we felt that asking for another survey that was completely optional for our students 7th through 12th grade would give us that information so we know how to best help students, how to prioritize where we want to start, what resources do they need, what programs do we have that are great, what programs do we might need, and what resources can we give those parents, which only would be the resources and supports for those parent nights in the spring. So again, just giving us that little kind of that lens to focus in on exactly where are the needs of our students so that we can best support them in the best way we can.
So as Courtney mentioned, we're always looking for ways of, you know, how can we really target so that we're addressing those specific needs of our students. And so as we have been talking about those kind of things, it happened to be, I had a personal experience. I have a teenager myself, 14-year-old boy, and he was in a particular youth group where they did a survey. In this student survey, they had the questions that they answered, and then they hosted a parent night. And during that parent night, they shared those survey results. I've seen survey results before about, you know, here's your national statistic or your state statistic about information of what our kids were dealing with. But when we were in that parent night and they were talking about those survey results, I had to pay attention because that survey was about the kids in that room. I couldn't say, oh, those must be kids from somewhere else. No, those were results about our kids. So it made it very personal for me. And then when we left, I really was able to have some really great conversations with my child about those survey questions. And he was able to open up because he could say, okay, Mom, all of those things are the survey, they weren't me. But my friend might have answered this, and then we were able to talk about conversations, you know, and that open dialogue with my child, it was what was so powerful. And so we started talking about how that was right in line with some of the things that we wanted to be able to bring here in Montgomery. So we started talking, how can we create a similar experience here in Montgomery ISD? So this is what we started talking about. How can we get there? The first thing we did is formed what we call an SOS committee. This is supporting our students. And so in this committee, we did reach out to our board members to ask for some nominations for some parents that could be on that committee. We had counselors, we had some community members, and then some of our leadership team on the committee as well. So during that committee, we started talking about that student survey. If we were going to put a student survey out there, what would it look like? We started with some sample surveys of what some other places have done, what some state surveys have looked like, and then we just started narrowing it down and saying, what questions do we really feel are valuable for us to know as a district and for our parents to know? And the questions needed to be things that we could work together to focus on because, you know, raising children takes a village, and how can we work together on some of these things? And so the survey questions ended up going towards three different categories. One was some mental health questions. Then we also had some questions about growing up in the digital age, because, you know, so many of our students have those cell phones or computer access, and so that was important. And then substance use as well. So the survey questions focus on that. And then the last part that we are working on is the parent nights. And so we'll have three parent nights that focus on those three categories. And during those parent nights, we're going to actually share those survey results with the parents and say, this is what a sampling of our students in Montgomery ISD answered. This is how we're going to learn more about the topic. We're going to learn more about ways that we can open dialogue with our students. We're going to learn ways, just actions that we can take then to help our students get through those things and manage those things in their life. And then we're gonna talk about, you know, okay, here's how you can talk to your student as a parent and a child, but then we're also gonna talk about, as a district, here are some action steps that we can take on our end as well, just to help work on these things. The final part that we want to present is community resources, so that when a parent leaves that parent night, if they feel like this is something that they need additional resources on, those community resources will be there where they can connect directly with them and seek some of those resources out immediately so that they have those next steps. So how can you help? When I say you, not just you, but you and everybody that's watching. There's just three different pieces. So the survey participation is one. One of the things that we did with the survey, as we talked about this, with that, okay, how do we get survey participation? And we talked about doing the survey during school and presenting it to students, but the more we talked about it, this was something that we really wanted our parents to have that control over, of whether or not they wanted their child to participate in the survey. Because as we mentioned, it talks about mental health, it talks about substance use, it talks about, you know, how they use their digital devices. So these are questions that can be sensitive in nature, and so we want that parent to be able to have that control to review the survey. The survey has been sent out to secondary parents where they can review it first, so they can be prepared to have any conversations that they might need to with their child after they take the survey, and then they can choose to give the survey to their child. Now, if they look at the survey and they say, you know what, I don't think that's what I want my child to see, they don't have to give it to their child. We are just hoping to get a good sampling so then we can use that information for the parent nights. So participating in the survey is one piece. Then the next part is attendance at the parent nights. We really are hoping to have a good turnout. So the more that we can communicate that and get people to come to those parent nights, we're trying to structure those so that we don't have competing events scheduled on the same night, so that everyone is available and to be able to attend. And then our last piece, those community resources. If you do know someone or a community business that can help in any of those three categories, we'd love for them to contact us and be a part of that community outreach on those parent nights. And our nights that we have reserved right now, the first one would be February 6th, and then March 2nd and April 3rd. So the final slide is just our contact information, so that if anyone wants to reach out with questions, I'm happy to answer any questions about the survey or the parent nights, or either one of us can help with the community resources portion of it as well. So questions.
Where are these going to be held, these parent nights?
So right now we haven't picked the specific location. We're going to kind of look to see where we feel will house the number of community resources we have. We may have it here, but if there's a large number of community resources that we may end up sending it up like vendor tables, and if we need more room, we may move it to one of the high school auditoriums.
Perfect. Other questions?
What kind of help did you need from businesses and?
So for these, the three categories that we're doing are, we have a mental health night. So if it's a business that maybe does like counseling services, or have some kind of maybe student groups or parent groups that they have information where they could offer support, then we would be able to have them come and offer some of that information. Growing up in the digital age, some of the people that we have spoken to are organizations that might have tools that can help you like monitor your students' activity online, those kind of vendors that could help with those different categories.
So feel free, yes, to send them to us. We can answer more questions and give clarifying information so they can decide if they want to participate or not. But we have wonderful resources in the area, and so we want to be sure to tap in and get those resources available to students and to parents. So.
Other questions?
Dr. Furlow, I just wanted to, again, thank Dr. Busby and Ms. Dyer. They not only have been doing yeoman's work putting all this together, but as always, we try to do a lot in terms of getting collaboration and partnership and feedback. So they've been doing road shows. They had a great meeting. I think you were able to attend, Dr. Fuller, with our faith-based community, who is doing a lot of this work, and so we got great feedback from them. And then they met with our PTO, PTA leaders, and so I just appreciate not only the outreach through surveys, but the interactions with different groups who have a vested interest in our success in this.
Thank you so much, ladies. Appreciate it greatly. Yeah. All right, information item 7B, goal 2, the police department update. Chief Phillips.
So Dr. Fuller, it is our goal 2 update and police department report all combined into one, because you can't really talk about our commitment goal 2 without talking about the police department, and just talking about the police department doesn't get the entirety of goal 2. So actually, Chief Phillips will be joined by Dr. Busby and Ms. Dyer again, And we will do the police department update and at the same time, goal two.
All right. So our agenda tonight, we will be presenting our discussion about the police department individual goals as it relates to goal two of the strategic plan. We will specify which strategies for each goal have deadlines passed and deadlines approaching, report on strategies that have been completed, and also report on strategies that have approaching timelines and actually what's next for our department. The five major overviews for our department deals with safety and security, education, crime prevention, community involvement, and also numerous training that the police department is involved in. So as we look at our org chart, you saw earlier this evening the officers who we have added to the police department, 14 total, and at each we have decided to put two officers at high schools, one at each junior high, and one at each elementary school. And they have been very successful in the transition into those schools thus far. Some more department updates. We have trained all secondary administrators on handheld wands, implemented department body-worn cameras, drug awareness presentations. We started those in 2022, and we will continue them in 2023, along with drinking and driving presentations. Also, we started last in 2022 and will continue in 2023. Joint alert training with local agencies. We have partnered with DPS to provide alert training in June of 2023. Where we will be having two classes, one at Oak Hills Junior and one at Lake Creek High School. And this will involve multiple agencies around the county, also around the state, because it has been placed on the website for training for police officers. And we have had numerous people to contact me to be involved in this training. We were fortunate to receive four ballistic shields from Montgomery County District Attorney's Office. And with those shields, the District Attorney's Office will be providing training in the near future for using those ballistic shields. We have updated our department policy. We've made some revisions to it to add to bolster up what we already have, and those policies have been given to our officers for acknowledgement and putting into place. We have also had a passing rating from DPS for our national incident reporting system. This is a system where we report all of our data to DPS in order so that they can kind of accumulate this data and make their reports at the end of the year. We also initiated the Stop the Prop program, and what this does is it is a sticker that we've placed on every entry-exit door to remind people who are coming through it, students, staff, that the door should remain closed at all times. It should not be propped open. It should not be held open and unattended. So that way that everyone knows that it's a safety issue to prop a door open. We all know about the unfortunate situation of Uvalde, and so we are making sure that our schools are safe and that everyone knows not to prop doors open. So these stickers are placed on all doors on all campuses. Also, we're continuing to See Something, Say Something program, and this is a posters that are placed around all the campuses. And you can connect with the QR code, and it will give you an opportunity to make suggestions, comments, compliments, concerns, and be able to report this to the necessary people that who view the app. It's added a text line to our Let's Talk app as well. So as we look at district campus safety teams, we will see that at the top of the pyramid, we have our District Safety and Security Committee. It oversees our central coordination of safety efforts and implementation of district's emergency operations plan. This team meets quarterly, so we have an opportunity to kind of oversee some of the safety measures that have been put into place for the district to add to our level of security and safety for our schools, our staff, and our students. The district safe and supportive school program teams, it provides oversight, support, and training for campus teams in order to create a safe and supportive climate and culture. It meets two times a year or as needed. Our campus safety and supportive team conducts threat assessments and reports on individuals who make threats against themselves or others and provides appropriate intervention and or consequences. And this team meets as needed. This consists of our police officers, counselors, and administrators. The Campus Parent Safety Committee provides opportunities for parents' input on campus and district safety procedures, and it meets once per semester. The cumulative measure of all of these teams lends to the fact that the district wants our campuses and all of our students to remain safe. So everyone has an input on what's going on in the district. So this summer, TEA issued some state requirements for us to follow. And one of them was the summer target safety audit. In this audit, we were to conduct an exterior door audit. That means that we went to every campus around the district to make sure that our doors were safe, that there were no malfunctions in the door, that the doors closed completely. And so when we did this, we found that we did have some deficiencies, but we fixed those deficiencies before we made this report to the state. Also, it required us to convene with our safety and security team, which we did that in July, to talk about these safety measures and how we were going to make sure that they were taken care of before the beginning of the school year. It ensured all campus staff, including substitutes, are trained on their specific LEA and campus safety procedures. All of these procedures are trained at the beginning of the year before the school starts so that everyone is aware of what they're supposed to do during an emergency situation. It scheduled all mandatory drills for the year, and these drills also have to be scheduled in advance before the beginning of the year, and all of that was conducted. So we want to ensure all threat assessment team members are trained. That means our counselors, our police officers, and whoever sat on these threat assessment teams would be trained, and they have successfully been trained. Review and, if necessary, update access control procedures. We have done that as well. For the new school year, access control procedures must include exterior door sweeps, ensuring doors are closed and locked at every instructional facility at least once each week while instruction is being conducted. So what our police officers do, we make sure there has been a spreadsheet created that each campus has the number of doors on that spreadsheet, and our officers go around checking the doors to make sure they're secure, make sure that no one is propping any doors open, and make sure that they're functioning correctly. This is state mandated that they do that. But it's only state mandated that they do it once a week. We do it numerous times per week. And it shows up on that spreadsheet where the principals, if there's an issue, can look at the spreadsheet and make any necessary corrections at that point. So verification of the audit completion was due September 9th, and we did submit it in a timely fashion. Completion of the basic operations plan was also a plan that they had initiated at the beginning of the summer for us to make sure our basic operations plan was complete and that it provided information about our threat assessment annex and our active attack appendix, which we had to add to the emergency operations plan. We were able to submit that plan as well before the deadline of October the 12th.
Chief, before you pass baton,
yes,
two quick questions. Is there any training or state requirement around safety that we are not in compliance with?
There is no training that we're not in compliance with. We are in compliance with all our training.
And more often than not, have you decided to go above and beyond any state regulations in terms of training or requirements for your officers?
Yes, we have.
And I know, Chief, as there's still learnings coming out of Uvalde, one of the big things has been this question of chain of command. Your first day on the job, did you and I have a conversation about chain of command?
Yes.
Was there any confusion about who would be in charge?
No confusion at all.
Was there any confusion 2 years ago when we had that conversation about when you might, if at any time, relinquish command?
No confusion at all.
All right, thank you, sir.
Well, hold on now, I got some questions. Chief, it's actually not a question. It's more of a statement for the public. This is something I study. School safety is something I study. It's something I care deeply about. I think every board member up here cares deeply about it. I have to attend all of the district safety meetings. We've put you through the ringer in terms of our plans, and I just want the public to know that even before Uvalde, safety has been something that we spend a part of every day. It's something that we have focused on just in every little way that we can. And we will not come out and tell you we're doing this and we're doing that and we're doing this, because that's a recipe for someone that has a bad intent, and we're not going to just share that information. But I do want the public to know, Chief Phillips and his crew have just put a ton of effort. Dr. Morrison, your team's put a ton of effort. I want to offer that reassurance. I don't know how else to say it, Chief, other than to just call it out. So thank you.
Thank you.
The Chief's not going to go far, because he's got more to talk about as we transition to the strategic plan update. And so goal 2 is all about safety. And as Dr. Fuller mentioned, this has been a focus for our district for a while. The strategic plan started in 2021, and that was a focus back then even. So goal two is that MIC will vigorously enforce policies and procedures that promote a safe and orderly environment. So we'll give you some updates there, and Chief's going to talk about objective 1.
All right, so MISD will provide a safe and orderly learning environment and rigorously enforce all safety and security measures by ensuring 100% of staff and students are trained on all required trainings, including active shooter, safety policies, procedures, and protocols. So KPI 2.1.1, all employees will participate in annual active shooter training. Our target in 21 was 100%. We have completed that training for 2021 and also 2022 and 2023 with 100%. All of our staff, even include substitutes, have been trained in our active shooter training. KPI 2.1.2, all employees will participate in training on the district safety plan annually. Once again, our target was 100%, and for 21-22, we were at 100% completion, and 22-23, also 100% completion. This is done at the beginning of the year before any students come. We train our staff on our safety measures and active shooter drills. This also, what we have initiated is our reunification. It's an ongoing training that we have with our administrators and all of our support employees.
So I know we said we weren't going to tell you everything we do, but I'm going to ask you a question here.
Yes, sir.
Does that include our substitutes?
Yes.
Does that include our bus drivers?
Yes, it does.
When you say all employees, you literally mean
every single
employees.
We meet with every division at the beginning of the year, our bus drivers, maintenance, substitutes, child nutrition, principals, teachers, paraprofessionals, everyone we meet with before the beginning of the year.
Thank you.
KPI 2.1.3, each campus will complete all district and state required safety drills, and I state again, this is a state requirement. What we have done is we created a drill accountability spreadsheet to record our drills, and each administrator has a safety administrator over those drills, and they input this information at the beginning of the year. So for fire drills, lockdown, lockout, evacuation, shelter in place for weather, shelter in place for hazards, and holes. We have these drills throughout the year. Last year, 2021, we had a 100% completion, and we are in the process of completing those drills this year. MISD will perform internal safety and security audits at all campuses every year and external audits every 3 years at a 100% completion rate. KPI 2.2.1, all facilities will participate and review their annual internal safety audit and correct any areas of concern in preparation for the state-required three-year external audit. The three-year external audit will be conducted in the spring of 2023. As mentioned before, the three-year audit is required by the state, but our annual audit is not a requirement. It is an enhancement to our three-year audit to make sure that we are taking care of any deficiencies that we find along the way with our annual audit. Our target in 2021 was 100%. In the summer, this past summer in August, we submitted to Dr. Morrison our report for our annual audit. There were few to little deficiencies, but we got those deficiencies corrected before the beginning of the school year, and so we completed it at 100%. We will start our annual audit again in March of 2023, but our three-year state-required audit will begin in the spring of 2023, maybe in January.
All right, objective three, MISD will implement best practices which will result in students, parents, and staff experiencing a safe and secure environment. So this was measured in the survey that was sent out. So the first one has to do with students and how they feel safe and secure in the school environment. And so when we did the baseline back in September 2021, 73% is where we scored with students. Our goal was to hit 76%. When we did the survey in October and that came back, we were at 75%. So we had made some improvements, not the 3% that we had targeted, but we were close. So we were glad to see improvements, but we are setting that next target then for 78% for next year. Some of the activities that we're hoping will address this, the DARE training that will be done with Chief Phillips. High school officers will be doing that summer of 2023. And then the student survey and the parent nights that we were just talking about, the parent nights, as mentioned, will focus on like substance use and mental health. So we hope that this will also help us meet that target. The next KPI was basically the same question, but this one was for parents and the parents' perceptions of feeling that safe and secure environment. Our target, when we did our baseline and that came back, we were at 90%. And so when we look at these types of goals, you know, when you hit that A mark, that 90%, you know, you really just want to kind of maintain that A. So rather than increasing 3%, the goal for this is to be at or above that 90% mark annually. And so when we did that October survey, it did come back at 92%. So we do want to continue the community involvement. This is something that Chief's Department has done, the Citizen Police Academy. That was a success last year. So they'd like to continue that in spring of 2023. Then, of course, the parent nights that y'all have heard about. And then the Watchdogs program is also something implemented this year to continue that.
Dr. Busby, if we can stop for just 1 second on these background information. A lot of our KPIs are populated either by state data, testing data, data that comes from various reports. That's the quantitative data. And then there's a lot of qualitative data that comes out of the parent, student, employee engagement survey that we get phenomenal results from that we do in the fall. Great participation, some of the highest in the entire country by parents and staff. And we're very proud of that. When we talked with the third-party vendor that does that survey work, and we said we were going to go ahead with our survey this fall, they prepared us that these data points may actually take a dive, because especially being in Texas, if you remember in October, we were still almost daily having reports about Uvalde and what was being learned, and it did give us pause that, well, what if the results come back not because parents or students or staff don't feel safe because of what we're doing, but just because of what they were seeing daily on the news. I want to compliment our board, because I did talk to our board about, are you okay with moving forward with the survey results, because it was entirely possible that these results that we're getting that are extremely strong could have come back artificially low, not because of anything perception of what Montgomery ISD is doing, but just because of the nature of what was happening at the time. And so when I say our board and our school district does not compromise on collaboration and transparency, we don't. We're very pleased with the results that we got, but I just want to say, while some other districts took a pass on these type of surveys, ours did not. And I really want to thank the board for allowing us to go forward with that survey.
So this third KPI is, again, same question, but this one was geared towards the staff. So again, our target is to be at or above 90% annually. Last year, we were at 94%, and even in that area, we saw an increase at 95% this year. So we were happy with those results. One of the things we talked about with our progress is that we were able to increase our police officers. So, you know, two officers assigned at both high schools, one at both the junior high schools and one at each elementary. I think that certainly contributes. So we appreciate being able to do that. And then continued support to the junior high and elementary schools with the Leadership Academy, and that's through work from Chief. So this is just a sample of some of our survey results and some of the questions that were asked that had to do with safety and behavior. The green is our parent results, the blue is our campus and staff, and then the yellow is students. One of the things that K-12 Insights informs us of is that normally you're going to see just this pattern. Your students always kind of fall below what your parents and staff do, so that's kind of a typical pattern, but that this pattern is a very high pattern for our school district, and all of these scores improved from 2021. So, and that's what we wanted to see, was that we were making progress.
The next KPI, customer satisfaction of the MISD Police Department, will be at or above 90% each year. Our baseline in September was 96%. And for October, our baseline went up 1% to 97%. This is the culmination of the parents and the staff. As you can see, for the students, we were at 75% for 2021, and we actually increased 6% to 81% for 2022.
Just in case you wanted to see it another way.
So you'll see this is a comparison to other departments, as the police department has a 97 percentage for both parents and staff.
All right. Okay, so as I shared earlier, goal two, objective four, focuses around student wellness. And so we have two KPIs that fall underneath student wellness. Oh, there they are. Thank you. The first one states that the number of mentors participating in the district mentor program will increase annually. So when we were able to bring the program back after COVID, we started last year in the fall with 40 mentors, and we're able to grow that to end the year with 47. So we had some growth, not where we really wanted to be. Sometimes with the mentor program, it's two steps forward, three steps back, because sometimes our mentors have to leave the program or students leave. So we're constantly trying to grow it and find mentors to participate with that. So the mentor programs are alive and well at our secondary campuses. This year, we're also welcoming mentors at the elementary campuses. So if we have a mentor who's interested in maybe having a mentee at the elementary campus, we try to pair them with that need there. So we're going to start the semester with some additional mentors when we get back from the break, and then that week when we return on the 11th, we're having another informational meeting about the mentoring program. So feel free to go out and grab that graphic off our MISD webpage and share that with any of your friends and family. If they can't make the meeting, no worries. I'm happy to meet with individuals about the program. If you have groups, organizations that would like to have me out, I'm more than happy to come and visit with them in their meetings that they may have monthly or weekly. So just let me know and connect me with those people, and I'll be more than happy to go and share about our program. Ms. Port, remind me, our program's been around probably what? Almost
2017.
Right. And so, you know, we also had some conversations on maybe we need to form a little committee, take a look at what's working well, what are some hurdles we have, how can we attract and recruit more mentors. So we'll be working on that in the spring as we move forward to the next school year. And then the second KPI reads that the percentage of students reporting that their social and emotional needs are being met by their school will increase by 3% annually. So last September, we had a baseline of 71%, and then with a target of 74%. So when we got the information back this fall, there were 72% of our students either strongly agree or agree to that statement. So again, we'll work closely with the counselors in those campuses to collaborate and brainstorm ways to better meet those needs of our students. Again, you know, going back to that student survey, why we feel it's so important. Again, so exactly, you know, why do they feel that their needs are being met or why they're not being met will give us a better picture of how we can support that piece. And then our staff, we want to be sure that our staff is equipped to help support those students as well. So each year we have required trainings through Edge a Hero that our staff members participate in that are focused around mental wellness, mental health. But we also, last year at Summer Summit, offered four different sessions that also were in addition to that. And we had great participation there. So we're looking forward to hopefully offering those and sessions like that this year too. So here's another graphic that kind of gives some input from parents and staff and students about how students feel that they're supported on campuses. Anywhere from how they feel supported with a school problem to a personal problem, way down to just an individual need. And so, as you can see, we have well over 50% in all the different areas, with most of them being way above and beyond that 50%. Again, we keep going back to that survey. So that survey is going to give us that important information to know exactly where we can pinpoint and when we can support.
Okay, so the next couple of slides just kind of highlight the different strategies that we are undertaking to kind of help improve these areas in Goal 2. So you can see that some of them say in progress, not started, or they are complete. The one that's not started is that DARE program, but that's already scheduled for the summer, so that's coming. And the other things are, some of these are just things that are kind of ongoing, continuous work. We did want to highlight a couple of things. The vaping monitoring and prevention was one of our focuses this year. We were able to put vaping detectors installed at both of our high schools and all of the restrooms as kind of a preventative measure. We've also talked and have had presenters come in and present to our high school and junior high on the subject of vaping. And then one of our parent nights is going to focus on teen substance use. And based on student survey, actually based on data I've already seen starting to come in, vaping is probably going to be a very one of our main topics that will be covered in that session.
And then as Dr. Morrison alluded to earlier about, you know, Maslow before Bloom's, and that's so important because students aren't able to learn or be their best selves if they don't have their basic needs met. And so our community partnerships in the community are phenomenal. Our students' non-academic needs are met. We have great partnerships with all different organizations and groups. TChat, just to name one, is the Texas Child Health Access through Telemedicine. It's a virtual online therapy counseling program through Baylor College of Medicine that is completely free to students. Their wait list is short compared to the others in the area. And last year we had over 25 students who participated. They can participate at school, or they can participate at home. We had 25 that participated. This year we're almost already up to probably 15. So to me, I feel like these are students that probably would not have received that support if we didn't have a service like this. So it's been a great program for our kiddos. The food bank, Montgomery County Food Bank, along with the Junior Service League, helping meet our food needs of our families and our students. Every campus is touched by the Montgomery County Food Bank in some way. They have a program that supports students. Probably on average, we have a backpack program. So on average, probably 100 backpacks go home with students, elementary and junior high, each week to provide that food need over the weekend. Yes to Youth is another organization here in the county, has different locations, provides free counseling services to our district. We have an MOU with them. Again, their wait list is also shorter compared to those other services that are free. So great supports to our families. Yes, Montgomery is a local group that supports our kiddos. Our faith-based leaders in those groups have been supportive, whatever those needs might be, as well as watchdogs. We currently have about 250 watchdogs that either have already participated or they're signed up to participate. So super excited about that. And in lieu of the Christmas season, we just have completed our Christmas support for our the families that need support at Christmas, our angel tree, and we had about 450 students who received support through our community. So thank you to all of you and all of our community who supported that we have kiddos that will have Christmas this year. So
I'd like to just pause, and if that doesn't warm your heart, there's not much that's going to warm your heart. So 450 kids have Christmas now because of the work you're doing. So thank you, Courtney, for all that you're doing. And thanks for our partners that are making that happen as well, too.
They do. There's a counselor will call, and I have resources. And those needs don't go unmet. So we have a wonderful community and partnerships. So.
Yeah, I want to highlight just one situation that happened. So they ended up with a last-minute call for a need of about 50 last-minute fills that needed filled by the weekend, and community reached out, community stepped up, and all 50 of those were met within a couple of days.
Yeah, new counselor, new to our district, new to the program, she called in a panic, and I said, do not worry, because I knew that our community would come through. So, within a couple hours, it was taken care of.
That's the kind of community stuff they make Hallmark movies out.
That's right.
Christmas. Our community's fabulous.
Good Hallmark. Varying quality.
Yeah, we're very, very appreciative of all of those community partnerships. Last thing we wanted to highlight is just digital citizenship, and we did highlight this last year too, but I think this is very important, especially as we are preparing for increased technology on all of our campuses. I know you've heard the technology update and all the devices that we're going to start seeing on campuses, so this is just that much more important. Each campus participated in that digital citizenship week, and students engaged in those lessons. Teachers were also trained and completed requirements so that they become certified and know how to keep kids safe online. And the more we have devices on class, the more important that's going to be. So while it was just a week dedicated to that there, these are ongoing lessons that they will be following through as they do instruction. And then in addition to that, I'm just going to kind of give a plug for Parent Night again, because this will be one of our topics of growing up in the digital age. And, you know, that's a challenge I know as a parent I have to deal with at home, and it's a challenge we'll continue to deal with at school, and we can partner with that as well. And so what's next for school safety? Well, we're going to just continue to improve those facility safety through improvements that are going to be supported by the bond work. We're going to continue to work on all of those strategies that you saw. And then we're going to focus a lot of those strategies to support students' mental health needs, well-being, and just feelings of safety. So questions for any of us?
Questions, ladies and gentlemen?
Yeah, you covered a lot.
And again, I had mentioned already, we've been very involved, highly involved in y'all's work and watching it very closely, and you're doing a lot of great work. So,
I think you guys are doing a fantastic job, and the mentorship program, I wish we had more time to talk about that, because that's been a big one. I mean, my wife's involved and enjoys every weekend to go do that, so I hope there would be a platform we could talk more about that.
Mentors. So.
I think, Mr. Rob, one of the things we have talked about is, you know, we talk about differentiation of instruction, and I think there's differentiation of support. And I think one of the things is with our mentoring program, there's like a one-in-the-box type of approach where it's this program, it's this way to do it, and we have a lot of different students with a lot of different student needs. And at the end of the day, it's about getting a caring adult in the life of our students who have had that need. And so what Courtney is going to do is engage counselors, our current mentors, administrators, but we think we can differentiate the mentor program. You know, part of it is the requirement right now, you come in, you have lunch, and there's X amount of time you have to, and you know, there are some students who absolutely need that that type of mentoring, and there's others that might need a different type. And so we're going to try to think out of the box and have a broader scope of how we can approach it and get more caring individuals in. We know through the watchdog program, when we put that need out there in a specific way, this community responds. So I'm really excited about what's going to be coming with the mentor program, and still continue the tradition of the mentoring program as it exists, but to enhance it and differentiate it a little bit.
We always get lots of interest, but then people, they, oh, once a week, that's a big commitment. You know, whether you're retired or you're in the working field, it's a lot. And so some people kind of shy away because they feel like they can't really truly fulfill that. So if we can kind of, like you said, differentiate a little bit and give some lead way there, I think we'll be able to have more mentors that will come on board with that.
Excellent.
Questions? All right. Thank you for all you're doing for our
Thank
schools.
Thank you, guys.
Next up, 7D, bond update.
So Dr. Fuller, as I think Mr. Lynn already mentioned, but this community was amazing in its support of our school district in the spring of last year with the passage of the bond. We were only one of seven school districts across the state that had all of its bond propositions passed. We want to make sure that we don't ever take that support lightly or for granted, and so we have made a commitment for as much transparency as we can present in the bond now that it's been passed to actually in the implementation execution. And so at each board meeting, as our board knows, we present updates. We have a site on our website dedicated to bond progress. And we just really want to make sure the community feels a sense of ownership over how we are progressing on those commitments that we made. So, Mr. Lund.
I just realized I'm the only thing standing between you and your winter break. So, in order to try and catch Chief Phillips, I'm going to speed through this. So, maybe that'll get me a couple of points and help me on the survey next year.
Mr. Lund, you did make some improvements, right, on the survey this year?
I did make some improvements. Thank you for noticing.
And you got into the what poll position this year?
Oh, I don't know. I know I'm not in the top two, so that's okay. We're making, you know, we didn't peak too early. We're
baby steps.
Some other departments.
Steady gains is how we like to look at it. We had a long way to go, but we're doing good. So Package A, Creekside Elementary and Lake Creek High School Edition, just a couple of things. Tonight you already approved the early release for Package 2. Next meeting, we will be bringing you the design development document, basically signifying that the design process for Creekside Elementary is complete, and we'll be asking for your approval. That will have the floor plans, layouts. During your small group meetings, we will actually go through interior finishes, so you'll get to see paint colors, tile colors, all kinds of selections. Once you give us that approval, then the architects can go finalize all the construction documents and get it ready for bid. That bid process is supposed to take place in March. We will bring you a guaranteed maximum price in April, and everything going well, construction will begin in May. And then once again, just a reminder, both of those facilities, Elementary 7 and Lake Creek Addition, are scheduled to open in August of 2024. Package B, which is our CTE and Ag Science Center. We had our second CTE design committee meeting right before we left for Thanksgiving break. We agreed on the programs, CTE programs that will be included in the facility. We discussed program and building adjacencies. So now we have a preliminary floor plan for a CTE center, which we will be working through a conceptual design and starting to share some of that information with you after the new year. Our Ag Science Center Design Committee toured ag facilities in New Caney and Tomball after Thanksgiving. So we have already had some discussions about potential layouts and number of pens needed for animals in our Ag Science Center. Package C, remember that's our renovations to Montgomery Junior High, Lincoln Elementary, and Montgomery Elementary. That design process is complete. Our bid process will begin in January. Marshall Construction will be leading that for us. We will be bringing you a guaranteed maximum price in February. And then depending on the campus, some construction may start as early as the end of March, first part of April. Some other campuses may not see activity until June because of the nature of work and where some of that work has to take place. Other upcoming project, you haven't heard us talk about this, but we've been working on it in the background. The replacement of the stadium lighting at the Montgomery High School Auxiliary Stadium. That was an item that was identified during the bond. So at your next board meeting in January, we will be bringing you, we'll be asking for your approval for the cost of that work. We have plans to begin that work starting in April. We're waiting till April because they currently use that as their soccer field, and soccer season doesn't end until the middle of March. Hopefully they make it to the playoffs, and that's why we're shooting for April. That work is scheduled to take about a month to 6 weeks to do, so hopefully estimated completion May 15th, 2023. Also, today we released the request for qualifications for Package D. So that is the renovations to Montgomery High School and the athletic complex. So when we return from Christmas break, we will be receiving submissions from interested contractors on that project, and we will be bringing a recommendation to you at your board workshop in January, at the end of January. So since the bond passed in May, like I said, I know we're not visually seeing things, but as we wrap up 2022 in the last 6 months, we've already hired three contractors. We have basically Elementary 7 and the Lake Creek High School Addition designed, pending your approval in January. We have renovations to Montgomery Junior High, Lincoln Elementary, and Montgomery Elementary School done, ready to start the bid process. And we have already started a significant portion of the design work for CTE and Ag Science Center. So while you can't visually see, we have been busy, and we're very proud of the amount that we've accomplished since the bond was passed in May. So I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions, board members?
What are you doing in your spare time?
Yeah, that's a good question. I'm trying to boost up my finance ratings.
Ratings,
yeah.
Okay.
I need some
votes.
You've
done a good job tonight.
Chief.
Got to catch the chief. Chase the chief.
Any other questions, board members, on this topic?
Dr. Flyer, I do want to acknowledge the great work that's happening on this. Chris's job basically doubled on the day the bond was passed. And how many additional staff members have we allocated for bond?
Zero.
So I appreciate it. But there's a colleague I would say a Robin to his Batman, but I actually think he is the Robin, and that is Joe Kennard, who does an amazing job already. But every time I see Chris in a meeting with architects or construction managers at risk, I usually see Joe, and you know, as soon as I see Joe, I feel very comforted. So Joe, thank you for your leadership as well.
All right. Board members, are there any other questions on that? Let's talk about budget, monthly financial report. Are there any questions on 7D? All right, hearing none, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to adjourn this meeting.